27th of June, year of our Lord 2023, and we're going live on Facebook and YouTube. Welcome if you're a student at the University of Houston and the Bauer College of Business. This is Personal Finance. I am going to jump into the Zoom room and let some folks in. Welcome. If you can, please let me know if you can hear me. I see you. Can you hear me? You can chat in if you would. Please chat in. Do remember to chat in the time that you join too. If you're in the Zoom room, please just put your name and the time that you joined this meeting. That will go into the record, attendance record. And so if somebody could just chat in and let me know you can hear me. I can see you. I can see some of you are connecting to audio. So welcome aboard. We're going to talk about the assignments that you have coming up for this week. Also want to review last week's assignment. Thank you, Matang. You can hear me. I'm assuming everybody else can hear me too. Thank you very much. Hi there. I got your email. Alawasian, I appreciate. I'll be thinking about you and your future. I did get your email. Sorry you didn't get mine until last night, apparently. But anyway, you bet. Thank you for letting me know too. We'll work with you any way we can. Just keep me posted and we'll figure it out. That's, your grade is the least important thing in your life right now. Maybe not the least, but anyway, very good. Okay, so we're going to talk about this week's assignments. This week's assignments, which you should be able to see, if you wouldn't mind just leaving a message in chat, if any of you can go into Canvas and just confirm that you can see two assignments for this week. One of them is bargaining and negotiating, and one of them is insurance review. So those are the assignments we're going to review a little bit today. Assignment, let me see. You should see how to bargain and negotiate, and you've got quite a bit of homework in terms of reading, a couple videos to watch and articles to write related to these two assignments in Canvas. So be sure to spend some time in Money Study Group. That's where the training, the educational content is for this week's two assignments. And there's a lot of information there about insurance. Typically, when we do this course in a normal session, not in the summer session. In the summer session, it is just really abbreviated and we go really fast. But in the normal scheme of things, we would spend 1 to 1.5 weeks on insurance. And even then, we just barely skim the surface because insurance is something that makes a big difference in your financial life. It is one of the biggest components in terms of expenses, one of the biggest expenses in your budget. So it's what I call a category of expenses, insurance. And whether you're talking about life insurance or car insurance or home insurance or business insurance or disability insurance or health insurance or long-term care insurance, or personal liability umbrella insurance, or commercial liability umbrella insurance. There are lots of ways to transfer risk to an insurance company through the premiums that you pay to purchase insurance. So we're going to focus in this assignment that's coming up this week, we're going to focus on car insurance. And car insurance is one way for you to get exposed to start learning about how insurance coverages work. There's plenty of information in an auto insurance policy that can help you understand insurance. So you're going to be doing, let me get on the insurance. This is very similar to what you'll see in your assignment in Canvas. So first of all, you need to know you bought a car, and I'm going to review the credit crush assignment. But you know, your assignment last week was to make some spending choices. One was to purchase a car, like your dream car. And some of you, many of you did a great, most of you did a great job on that assignment, by the way. I wish I could drive all of your cars. I'm a car guy and I love to drive really anything. Anything with an engine, electric or, you know, internal combustion. I'm a car guy. And so I love to drive stuff. And I see your cars and I'm like, whoa, that would be a cool car to drive, especially some of those Teslas that you bought. So that's cool. But now we're going to talk about how do you protect that asset. And if you have a loan, which you do, because in your assignment, I required you to have a loan for the vehicles, for the house, those two assets with a loan on them require you to buy insurance. So if you have a loan on your house, a mortgage, your mortgage company is going to require that you insure your home, and they call it insurance to value. So if you have a $500,000 house, you have a loan, a mortgage loan, you cannot underinsure your home. You have to insure it for what it would cost to rebuild or replace your home in the event that it was destroyed in a hurricane or a fire. And so you're going to have to do a little research this week to figure out how much is it going to cost to insure that house that you purchased. Same with your car. You're going to do a little research. In fact, you're going to have to get a quote on your car. Now, I'm going to give you a little guidance about how to do that in today's lecture, but that's what's coming. I'm going to review the insurance assignment and help you understand a couple of tricks, a couple of easy ways for you to get that quote. Even if you don't have a car or even if you don't have a license, you're going to need to get an insurance quote. That may mean you have to work with somebody who does have insurance. And I'll give you some guidance for how to do that. So that's one of the things we're going to do is this week, you're going to add insurance to your financial plan. Every client that I have, one of the things we do, and when we start out with their planning engagement, I call it a thoughtful gap analysis. And that gap analysis includes reviewing every area of their financial life. And one of the most important areas, I call it an essential element of financial planning, is the risk management or insurance planning. Everyone who has a financial plan needs to spend some time reviewing the potential gaps that they have in terms of protecting their assets. And there are so many assets to think about in terms of protecting your assets. And so in this week's assignment, you're going to be covering or filling in one of those gaps that you have. Now that you have a home and you have a car, you need to have some protection, some insurance protection. So you're going to learn about insurance coverages, specifically home and auto, because those are the two most common, those are the two most common types of insurance that people need to buy. And again, if you have a loan on your home, a mortgage, or a loan on your car, a car loan, you are required to carry full coverage. When I say full coverage, I mean you have to cover those assets, the car and the home, sufficiently so that if they are destroyed in a hurricane or a fire or a theft or whatever, an explosion, you have to make sure you have protection so that you can replace those items because the bank requires that. So if you happen to be wealthy enough to not carry insurance, you still have to have insurance on your cars, to drive. You have to have liability coverage, but you don't have to have what most people call full coverage, which means collision and comprehensive. So you're going to learn a lot about that this week. I would love to sit here and teach you all about that. I could do that with my eyes closed. I know way too much about insurance. If there's one thing I'm an expert in, one thing that, and I'm not really proud of this either, but insurance is an area of specialty that I've invested a couple of decades. I was a State Farm agent for many years. I have a lot of letters after my name, and most of them are basically hundreds of hours of study and mastery in the area of insurance and all kinds of insurance. So, and plus, I also have spent much of my career, at least my side hustle career, as an adjuster. So I was it's what we call a staff adjuster at State Farm. That's how I started my career in the financial services business. So I was trained by the very best. I was actually hired into a training unit in Houston. It was called the Astrodome office. It was on Holly Hall Road Avenue, whatever, right next to the Astrodome. And that's where I moved to Houston from Austin to take that job. And it was the first training unit of its kind for State Farm anywhere. And I don't know that they ever did it again. They had a big need. They needed to hire folks and train them. And so they put together the very best personnel we had in the Houston area and created this training unit. And I was a byproduct of that. It was one of the best gifts in my professional career to be part of that and to get the kind of training that I got in that unit. And then I moved out of that unit and went out into the field and got promoted a few times and then ultimately became a State Farm agent. So that's kind of my backstory for my career, but it really is the foundation of my expertise in insurance. So I would love to spend an entire semester teaching you about insurance, but it's not part of the scope and sequence of this course. But what is part of the scope and sequence of this course is this week's lesson, where you're going to have to take the initiative to learn some things about insurance. Now, I'm happy to answer any questions you have. If you have questions and you want more content, I will be happy to do extra lessons just so you can have more information. I'm working on that already for another course that I'm designing. But for you guys, you know, I know you have a lot on your plate. It's summertime. We're going really fast, and you have more than you can process right now in this course. So just trust me this week, read the content, absorb as much as you can about homeowners and auto insurance, focus on getting your data cards right in your financial plan. Just by doing that one thing, by putting the data cards into your financial plan, let me show you the data card. So this is an auto insurance data card, and that data card that you're looking at right there, and it's a link to this post, is in the video that you're watching right now. And as always, these Zoom meetings are being recorded and live streamed to YouTube and Facebook. So if you're watching on YouTube or Facebook, you can look in the links, the comments below, and you'll see a link to each of the posts that I'm talking about in today's lecture. And so this image, this data card, that's an auto insurance data card. So you're going to need one of these in your financial plan. It's part of this week's assignment. You're going to have to give me a picture. And when I review, when I grade your article, your assignment for the insurance, I'm going to be looking to see what kind of coverages you got. You see this student has a zero deductible. That will be a deduction. They have collision coverage with a zero deductible. That's not how it works. Now, there used to be places you could buy comprehensive insurance with a zero deductible, but this student doesn't even have comprehensive. So this data card is you know, one of the data cards I grabbed from a student's assignment, and this one got some deductions. And if you turn in a data card that's incomplete like this, you'll get deductions as well. So pay attention to that. Again, if you learn enough this week to simply be able to complete, to add your automobile to your insurance without any deductions, you will have learned a good deal about insurance. And that's the objective here. So start with this data card and just start thinking, okay, all of those details in that data card represent very important pieces of the insurance puzzle relative to your car. Okay, so again, I want you to learn enough about insurance, especially in auto and homeowners insurance, so that you can become an effective consumer of insurance. You're going to spend a lot of money on insurance in your lifetime, and I want you to be smart enough to make informed decisions about your insurance program. Auto and home is a big part of that, so that's where we start. But I promise you, if you can become a smart consumer of insurance in those two areas, auto and home, you will be building a foundation that you can build on over your lifetime to make it so much easier for you to understand how insurance works. Whether you're talking about business insurance and liability, there's two types of insurance in most policies. I'm talking about property and casualty at the moment. Property and casualty insurance means, on one hand, in one section of the policy, you are paying a premium to protect your asset. So you're protecting yourself and the bank in the event that something happens to your car or your home. It gets burnt, it gets destroyed in a hurricane, whatever. Your insurance then, because of the premium that you're paying, your insurance will replace or repair that piece of property. That's section one, property section of a property and casualty insurance policy for both home and auto. So that's section one. It's property. The other section, section two, is liability. It's a very important section. It's part of every property and casualty insurance policy, whether you're talking about auto, home, business, boat insurance. So I have an RV. RV insurance has both property, which covers my property, and if I have a loan, it covers the bank as much as it covers me. If I don't have a loan, it's just covering me. If something happens to my car, my RV, you know, if I drive it through a flood, it's covered under comprehensive. If I run into another vehicle, or I crash into a tree, or I try to avoid an animal and I run off the road with my RV or my motorcycle or my car, then that would be considered a collision. If I avoid hitting an animal and I run into a tree, that would be collision coverage, which means I would then have a deductible that applies to my collision coverage. Now, I'm getting a little inside baseball, but you need to understand this is really key in terms of insurance. It's key to know the different coverages. And it's funny, not funny, but it's interesting that in a car insurance policy, this comprehensive coverage includes damage from running into an animal. So it would be good for you to know that if you run into a big deer out on the country road and you run into the deer and it damages your vehicle, you're going to be covered under comprehensive coverage. And the reason that you really want to know that is for two reasons. One is usually, often, your comprehensive coverage is lower, the deductible rather, on your comprehensive coverage is lower. At least I do that with my policy because it's cheap to have, it's cheaper to have a lower deductible on comprehensive. And comprehensive is hands down on the automobile coverage called comprehensive. Okay, this is a little helpful information. Remember, I'm an expert in insurance, and I'm about to tell you what my favorite coverage is on any policy that I've ever purchased or ever used. It's comprehensive on my auto. It's very different than collision. Comprehensive coverage covers what do you think? I'm not going to take time to hear your answers, but I want you to think about, and I want you to post a comment if you're watching on YouTube or Facebook. This would be a good class collaboration component for this week. What do you think comprehensive coverage covers? Now, probably you're not going to get it right unless you ask ChatGPT or Siri or do a Google search, and then you'll know that comprehensive coverage, you'll know what it covers and what's excluded, and you should know that. But I'm telling you, the best coverage on any policy is comprehensive coverage. Two things. One is you can keep a lower deductible, which means if you have damage from comprehensive, and comprehensive covers whole lot of stuff. I mentioned flood, fire, theft. It doesn't cover collision. So anyway, comprehensive coverage, my favorite coverage of any coverage. You can have a lower deductible, and if it's a coverage that covers so many things, that seems like a good idea to me. That seems like a wise way, one wise way to set up your insurance program so that you get the best bang for your buck, because you have a much higher probability of having a loss under this coverage that is going to be paid for by your insurance company. And you can have a lower deductible. And here's the key thing about comprehensive that makes it very special. If you have an accident with collision, you're going to have a deductible. This student failed to put a deductible in, but you're going to see when you do your insurance quote that your collision deductible, in order to keep your insurance premium as low as possible, as reasonable as possible, you're going to want to have a higher collision deductible, especially if you're young. And especially if you're a young male, because you pay more insurance than young females, and you certainly pay more than old dudes like me. So if you have a car like your Tesla and you have a low collision deductible, you're going to pay out the nose for that policy. So you're going to want to increase that deductible to save money on your policy. And when you do that, that means if you get in an accident, if you're running down the road in the country and you see that deer, you want to hit the deer. You don't want to turn off the road and run into a tree, because you're going to pay a deductible for collision if you run into the tree. It's going to be your fault if you run into the tree. If you run into the deer, it's the deer's fault. You shouldn't have been on the road, and you get to file a comprehensive claim and have whatever deductible that is on your comprehensive. And you're not going to get surcharged. Your insurance rates are not going to go up because you have a comprehensive claim. I'm going to pause, and hopefully you're hearing what I'm saying. On one hand, if you use your collision coverage on your auto, chances are you're going to have a higher deductible, which is going to cost you out-of-pocket money. But the other thing, the more important thing, is if you have a collision, if you run off the road to avoid that deer or that bear or that dog or that bull or that cow that got out of the fence, whatever it is, you avoid that and you run into a tree. Now you have a collision claim, and you will get you will most likely get a surcharge on your insurance premium. For 3 years, your rates will go up. And if you're a young man, your rates are already sky high. And if they go up, they're going to go up a lot. So that's a little inside baseball. It may be on your quiz. It should be on your quiz. But more importantly, it's something you should know if you want to become a wise consumer of insurance. Just these are the kind of things that, you know, when I was a State Farm agent, when I would sit down with a client to do an insurance review, I would always be telling stories about different coverages so that my client understood, you know, what was the most effective way to use their insurance dollars to give them the most coverage at the lowest price. I had hundreds of stories because there are hundreds of coverages, and most of the time, nobody wanted to sit and listen to me talk about their insurance. And I was just trying to do my job and make it easy to understand. And so I'm assuming it's the same with you. You're probably bored by now and ready to move on. There's so much I could share with you about insurance, but I just shared a little bit about this auto coverage and these two different coverages, your auto policy and two different coverages. And then we get into homeowners insurance. And so this is a data card for your homeowners insurance, and I'll be looking at those because you're going to add your home to your insurance policy. So pay attention. Some of you are going to forget to say, yes, I own a home, and you're going to have your data card say, when you put that property into your plan, you're going to have to put the property, the home, into the plan. You should do the same with your auto because it's an asset. It's an asset that has value. And if you put that property, if you add that to your financial plan, it will show up as an asset. Now, if you have a loan, it's going to show up as a liability, but still they balance each other out. So in, especially with your home, if you add your home as property that you own, then it becomes an asset that you own. And yes, you have a mortgage loan over here, but as you're paying that loan off, what happens to your balance sheet inside of your financial plan? It's always calculating the difference between the asset, the property that you added to your plan, and the loan that you have, which is added to your plan already. You did that last week. But this week, you're going to make sure that the property is added, that you own the property. You're not renting it. That's the only way it's going to show up as an asset in your plan. You add that to your plan, and then you also add the insurance in your plan. So let me go here real quick and just make sure you know how to do this. I'm going to log in to Wright Capital real quick. Hopefully I'll go to the dashboard. I'm going to go to Billy's plan. Billy's my guy. I like to use his plan. Let me get my iPad where I can see it. So when you go to profile in your plan, you see that's the upper navigation all the way to your right. You're in net worth. That's where you do most of your stuff in terms of adding things. So let's see. You see this property section right there? That's where Billy has added the property that he owns, and that's what you're going to have to do. So when we go to property, we'll see his primary home. We'll see that he owns it. Now, if you forget to change that to own, then you don't have an asset. And I'll give you, when I see it, I'll give you a deduction because it's like, okay, we talked about that. And so this is what I'm saying. These are the details that I am expecting you to get this week. There's so many things you're going to learn if you do the homework. But at the end of the day, you're going to get graded. Your grade is going to be based on how well do you see, because these fields, they all represent details related to these assets and the expenses related to these assets. And so that's what I want you to be thinking about in terms of learning how to manage your money. I want you to be thinking about assets and liabilities and expenses. And that's what these data cards are all about. So the way you're going to do it, you're going to link an account. You're not going to link an account. You're going to add an account. So let's say you haven't added your home yet. You're going to add an account. You're going to add, what do you think you're going to add? Let me guess. Property. And then you're going to turn around and add insurance. So that's as far as I'm going to go in giving you the answer for this week's assignment relative to your insurance review. That's where you add it. That's where you do what you do. So hopefully that helps. If you have any questions, I am looking at the chat and I don't see any questions. So I'm going to assume that you guys have it down. Okay. It looks like Erica is trying to join and I'm going to say, nope. What happened? I'm just going to say too late. This is new. No, it's not going to let me. Anyway, sorry. So in case you didn't know, I try to give you like 5 minutes at the beginning of each Zoom meeting. If you're not here, I'll wait 5 minutes. After that, I'm not going to let you in because I don't want to, I don't want to review, you know, what we've already covered. So sorry, Erica, you're out. You'll have to watch the live stream. And please remember, you guys that are here, if you don't mind maybe posting this in GroupMe every once in a while, that each week we do this Zoom meeting. It is required. It's not required that you be here because it is an asynchronous course, but it is required that you watch the Zoom meeting. And the Zoom meeting is always posted in the playlist for the semester, and you have one, and this will be posted there. And if I were you, when I watch it on YouTube, I would watch it at double speed because you can listen faster than I can talk. Okay, so that's homeowners. Let's talk about, I want to review your credit crush assignment, and I could do that last or I could do it now. But we have this assignment, bargaining and negotiating. I'm going to ask if anybody has a preference. If you have a preference, let me know now, and I'll go with whatever you want. I want to review the assignment, this week's assignment, bargaining and negotiating. And I want to review last week's assignment, credit crush. So I'm going to, nobody's commenting. this week's assignment first. Okay, thank you, Meredith. We will do that. I appreciate your request, and I'm happy to do that. So this is this week's assignment on bargaining and negotiating. It's really a simple assignment. But here's what I want you to think about. The reason that this assignment is part of personal finance, with all the things we have to cover in this course, especially in the summer session, I want you to think about for a minute, what is the value to you as a consumer of being decent at bargaining and negotiating? Now, if we were together, and this is how for years and years I would set this up, this would be a lecture. We would spend the whole day. It was a lot of fun, not the whole day, the whole session, the whole class time, talking about bargaining and negotiating. And we'd start out by saying, okay, tell me, which group are you in? And I would pretend that on this side of the room, these are the people who are afraid to negotiate. They don't want to negotiate. They don't like negotiating. It's bargaining and negotiating feels awkward, uncomfortable. It's just something they don't like to do, the people on this side of the room. But then the people on this side of the room, my side of the room, over here, these people in my side of the room, we love to bargain and negotiate. And so for years, I taught this course using Dave Ramsey's content, and he had some pretty good content. But my favorite content, my favorite lessons he ever did were related to his teachings about bargaining and negotiating. And Dave Ramsey is a hardcore negotiator, and he's got some ideas that are a little bit outdated. Like, for one thing, he thinks cash is king, which, you know, it used to be, but today if you walk into Best Buy with cash, they're going to be like, we don't even want to take your cash, credit card, whatever. So anyway, Dave is really big on walking into a store with a, you know, with cash money, putting it down and making a deal and bargaining a better deal. But again, cash isn't what it used to be. So, but at any rate, Dave Ramsey loves to bargain and negotiate. So he was always fun to listen to. But here, before I get into the assignment, I just want to kind of set the table why this assignment is important. And I want you to think about, if you're on this side of the room and you love to bargain and negotiate everything you can, and things that people on that side of the room, because people on that side of the room don't really like to negotiate. People on that side of the room avoid bargaining and negotiating. And people on that side of the room are just not thinking about bargaining and negotiating. While people on that side of the room, my side of the room, we, every time we buy anything or, you know, spend money, we're thinking, people on that side of the room are thinking, how can I make a better deal? Right? And if you're on that side of the room and you don't like to bargain, it's uncomfortable, it's awkward, then basically you're missing a few opportunities here and there for sure. Because I promise you, people on that side of the room are making deals on things you never even dreamed you could make a deal on. And there are a multitude of things that people on that side of the room are able to get a better deal on just because they're thinking, hey, everything is negotiable. I bargain and negotiate on everything. And people on that side of the room, people like my wife, they avoid it and they don't even think it's possible. And we could go through item by item of things that people on that side of the room have bargained and negotiated. And people on that side of the room, on the other side of the room, on my wife's side of the room, they'd be like, no way, you can't bargain and negotiate that. We don't have time to get into that list today, but here's what I want you to think about. And there's no right answer, but I want you to think about, what is the value over your lifetime versus people on this side of the room, my side of the room, who bargain and negotiate everything, and people on that side of the room, on my wife's side of the room, who really think that bargaining and negotiating is something they don't feel good about it, it's a little awkward, and they just avoid it. What is the value over your lifetime? So the way I usually set it up is, let's say that everyone in both sides of the room makes $100,000 and we all have exactly the same basket of bills, the same items. We all buy a car, a house. We all have a computer. We all have Wi-Fi. We all have phone service. We all have a house. I said house. We all pay property taxes. But people on my side of the room, we will fight our appraisal on those property taxes every year to get them down. People on that side of the room, my wife's side of the room, would like, no, I'm just going to pay whatever taxes they want me to pay. Same with buying a used vehicle or a new vehicle, or, you know, using coupons for groceries, or shopping around and saying, hey, that store's got a better deal, but the store over here, like, for example, Walmart, I don't know if they still do this, but they used to. So I have an HEB right down the street from my house, and it's awesome. I love HEB, but their meat is, like, they have great sales on meat, but it's usually garbage. I mean, it's like not the best quality meat. On the other hand, Walmart has really good quality meat, at least they used to. And if you're having a sale at HEB and you went into Walmart, used to be you could just say, hey, here's the sale price for HEB, and they would honor that coupon. So that's a way of bargaining and negotiating, in my opinion. Because you could walk out of Walmart with, like, you know, a really good price on meat that was much higher quality than you would get at HEB. That's just one example. I mean, students have told me over the years, you can't bargain and negotiate on groceries. That's one thing you can't. And I'm like, well, wait a minute, maybe you can. Maybe you think about it. Now, people on that side of the room, on my side of the room, we're going to figure out a way to do it. While people on that side of the room, my wife's side of the room, are going to be like, yeah, you just can't do that. Same with phone service, Wi-Fi. If you don't negotiate on those deals, you're probably paying twice as much as I'm paying. So I have hundreds of stories about bargaining and negotiating, but again, we don't have time today to go over them. In fact, I'm running out of time, so let me get through the assignment. You're going to watch a video with this fellow. I met Ramit Sethi a few years back. Great guy. He's still doing what he's doing. He teaches young people. He had a website, I Will Teach You to Be Rich. And when I met him, that was what he was doing. So anyway, you're going to watch a video where Ramit and Justin, I believe is his name, they're going to talk about how to negotiate salary. And you're going to write an article and kind of summarize the video. And it's a great conversation, but it's really just to set the table for you to start thinking about ways that you can improve, and maybe not even improve, maybe just take the first few steps in terms of bargaining and negotiating, and recognizing that, yes, in terms of your financial future, it makes sense for you to develop a few basic skills in bargaining and negotiating. And yes, for those of you on that side of the room, maybe it makes sense for you to think about what your financial situation could be like if you started to think like people on that side of the room, like my side of the room. That's what I want you to learn. I want you to commit. If you're already bargaining and negotiating everything great, you're just going to tell me your story and how you do it. You're going to tell me who you know who's a great bargainer, negotiator in your family or in your life. I just want you to tell me who that is and what makes them good at bargaining and negotiating. But mostly I want to know, what are you going to do to take advantage of an opportunity to bargain and negotiate on something that could save you some money and help you achieve your financial goals? That's what this assignment is about. And it starts with a conversation with yourself about where do you sit in that room in terms of your capacity or your willingness or your tendency to bargain and negotiate. I just got to notice that my phone is going dead, so let's get done with this assignment before that happens. Sorry about that. Okay, so you're going to watch this video. You're going to summarize it. You're going to learn a lot about bargaining and negotiating salary, which should help you recognize, again, in the big scheme of things, how bargaining and negotiating fits into personal finance. Specifically, if you share my goal of wanting to become a millionaire by the time you're 50, bargaining and negotiating could be a really helpful piece of that puzzle. Trust me on that. It may not seem like personal finance to you, but I promise you it is. It does affect your bottom line in big time ways. So that's that. Let's see what else is on here. Yeah, I want you just to tell me about your experience. I want you to tell me what you're planning on bargaining and negotiating. It's all in the article. And then I have a video. You don't really have to watch this video. I think it's kind of long, but it's one of the videos I did in a lecture where I talked about what I think are the top seven bargaining and negotiating skills or elements. So that's all that is these. I just talk about these seven things that I want you to understand that I think are pretty important when it comes to bargaining and negotiating. So again, in this video, there will be a link to this article and to this article and this article. This is, now I'm done with the two assignments that are due this week, and I'm just going to bounce through last week's assignment. Now, unfortunately, most students did not turn this assignment in early this week. I'm sure it's because you're busy. I'm sorry for that, because if you missed the most important screenshot, if you did what several students did in terms of this mistake I'm about to show you, you're going to get a deduction. It's not a big deduction, but this is what I call the most important screenshot. And again, I'm not going to go over each area of this. I just want you to know this is what this is the screenshot you should have sent to me that shows the total amount of savings and how many months, the results of your strategy. And typically this is the strategy that works the best. You pay off your debts from highest to lowest interest rates. But I wanted you to do a little experimentation, play around with it, and see what you found in your plan based on your debt. The debt that I made you put onto your plan, the car, at least $10,000 in credit card debt, and your mortgage. So one of the things I want to point out is several students were having no results. Like, they would go in and change their debt strategies and their plan, just like the assignment said to do, and they would see pretty much no results. Well, almost always the reason that that happens is because let me go over here and go to goals. So Billy's got several goals, and you probably have several goals. But most of the time, almost all the time, you have problems with this credit crush assignment is because you've added a goal. Like, the number one goal that will mess up this assignment is you want to have another house. So I didn't give you that assignment. I didn't tell you to put a goal in your plan to move in 10 years and upgrade your house. But many of you like to do that, and that's awesome. But when you do that, it changes everything in terms of your financial plan, and it definitely changes your debt. So when you go to debt, this right here, to change your debt strategy, if you have an extra goal in there to move, change houses, what happens is you have to sell your original house. So there's this huge lump sum payment, and it's not really accounted for in your plan, but it just screws everything up. So if you turned in your assignment and you're not showing any results, then that's most likely why, because you added an additional goal and it, you know, you didn't know what you were doing sufficiently to be able to make this assignment work. Now, one other thing I want to point out, you don't get a deduction for this week, but when you do your capstone, remember, every one of these assignments are going to end up in your capstone assignment. So if you get something wrong along the way, you may or may not get deductions in the week that you submit the assignment. But when you do your capstone assignment, I'm telling you now that you're going to get deductions if you miss things like this. How big is that number right there? Can anybody tell me how big that number is? Total savings of how much? What's that number? We're all looking at the same number. And that's how much this student had for savings. This may be Billy. And this is Billy. So what does that tell you? It tells you that either this client, this student, this person has a ridiculous amount of debt relative to their overall, and a lot of, they're paying high interest. So that could be true. I've seen some really remarkable numbers when I'm working with clients and helping them figure out debt strategies, but this is $1 billion. And so I just want you to be aware, I'm not going to make a deduction here, but if you were this student and you turned in this screenshot and you didn't comment on how much that was, that $1 billion, and you're just like, oh yeah, I saved $1 billion. I'm going to be like, hello, did you notice how big that number was? Because if you didn't notice, you didn't comment, then I'm going to be like, you missed the point. You're putting down a number that's astronomical. Now, $1 billion is a lot, but I've received some of these where it's in the tens of billions. So I'm just saying, when you do your capstone assignment, those will be pretty significant deductions. I'm telling you now. So please share that in your group me for the students who are not paying attention and not going to hear this announcement. It's very important. Again, I'm not going to make a deduction if you turn it in this week's assignment, but I am going to be highlighting it now. So I'm highlighting it now. Same thing is going to happen when we do the, let's go to retirement. So you're going to do this in the next couple of weeks, and you're going to see a number that says, here's my probability of success, and here's how much money I have at the end of my plan. $3 million, if you did your capstone assignment and you had $3 million left over, I'd be like, cool, good, great. But if there's an extra, you know, three zeros there and you have $3 billion left over and you don't even comment on it, you're going to get a deduction on your capstone. So that is kind of I did do a podcast episode and a video for the Credit Crush assignment just to help you make sure you get it right. And again, I'm not going to make a deduction if you have, too much. If you're saving $100 million, I'm going to be like, hopefully you commented on that, because I will comment on it, but I probably won't give you a deduction this week. But it will be a deduction on your capstone. So That's what we wanted. That's what I wanted to cover in the review of last week's Credit Crush assignment. Any questions? We're running out of time, and my phone battery is looking pretty weak. So any questions, comments?
Yes.
Yes,
yes, Professor. So I have one question, not about like this assignment, but in the past, I submit the assignment and you send me a comment to like fix it, and I fixed the assignment and I never got the grade for it. So
did you resubmit it in Canvas?
Yes.
Did you, and you didn't get, so tell me, you didn't get, I didn't grade it, or you didn't?
Well, I got the grade for the first assignment, like, and because it was, I think, mistake, so I got a less point. But after that, you sent a comment just to fix it and resubmit it, so I resubmitted the whole assignment again.
So let me ask you this. Did you turn your assignment in early the first time?
I think I submitted on a Sunday night because I work full time, so before the due dates.
So you got some deductions when you initially turned it in?
Yes.
And then when you turned it in again, you did not get any extra points?
I didn't get the grade for the second time I turned it in.
Okay. So I owe you some points. That sounds like I made a mistake.
Yes.
I will fix that. It's Matang, right?
Yeah, Matang Patel.
Okay. Which assignment are you talking about?
It's few of them. I think it's two or three of them, but let me just let you
Now, did you turn the assignments in on time?
Yes, it was a Sunday night because the assignment is due Monday morning at 10 o'clock, 10 a.m. So
Tuesday morning at 10 a.m.
Yeah, Tuesday morning. Yeah.
So as long as you turned them, as long as you made corrections and turned in the corrections by Tuesday at 10 a.m., then you will get the extra points for making the corrections. But if you turned in the corrections after the due date, you won't get any extra points.
Okay. I think it probably will be some of them, one of them is a late one.
Yeah, so in always when you're resubmitting an assignment, this is helpful. It helps me help you. For you to put some notes in there. You know the little section where you can put a note to me when I grade it?
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
So just put a note in and say, I corrected this and this. If you do that, then I will know when I see your note, I will be way more likely to go ahead and fix it and give you some extra points. But if you just resubmit it with no comments, I'm doing, 100 assignments a week and I'm not going to see it. Chances are I'm just going to be like.
I post when I finish all the mistake, all of them, and I post a comment on all of them.
Okay. Well, then I made a mistake and I owe you a correction and I will fix that.
Yeah, can you just recheck it and this should be all? Yep. And put the comment, you cannot turn it. So recently I didn't know how to post the comment like 2 weeks ago. So I just started posting 2 weeks ago, like on the comment. So
okay.
I cannot do it, right? The past assignment.
No, but when you turn in your new assignment, you can.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I did that. Thank you.
Yep. Good. I'll go back and check. And again, for students who are turning, so if you turn your assignment in early, and I grade it and I give you some deductions and I say, go fix this. If you turned it in early and then you turn around and make corrections and submit it, let's say midnight, Monday night, Tuesday morning at 8 a.m., whatever, make sure you tell me in the little comment section, I turned this in early and I'm submitting my corrections. And then I will plug in 60 points. As long as you got everything right instead of 50. But if you don't give me those comments, I can't promise you, you're just going to make work for you and me if you don't do that, because, I'm a nice guy. If you tell me later that happened, I'll come back and give you the 60 points, but I don't want to have to do the extra work. I don't want you to have to do the extra work. And trust me, for me, if, 10 students a week make that mistake, it turns into quite the little extra assignment for me. So help me help you, please. Those comments, I give you comments if there's any, if you get any deductions. I feel like I owe you comments. If you did great on the assignment, at this point, I'm probably not giving you comments because I know you're busy and I'm busy and you did great. So I just give you the points. But if I give you any deductions, I feel like I owe you comments. And I feel like you owe me comments if you're asking me to, you know, just remind me. That's all I'm saying. It will be helpful. That will help me help you. And I appreciate it. Matang, I'll go check those and make sure I get those fixed today.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
You bet.
Sir, I have a similar issue with one of my assignments. Thank you.
Sure. And your assignment was it late? Was it, what was?
No, I submitted early before the Friday 3 p.m., but I made a mistake of submitting a wrong document.
Got it.
So I updated it immediately. I saw your comment, and I also put it in the comment section.
Okay, you resubmitted it, and I haven't graded it yet, the new one, right?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Cool. So, and you told me, because I remember you turned in, like, assignment 3, and it was supposed to be assignment 5. Yep.
Yes.
Okay. So, yeah. So, you resubmitted that. I should see it in my queue with your notes, and I'll give you 60 points.
All right. Thank you, sir.
You bet. Thank you. Anyone else? Going once. I'm going to go over and end the broadcast now. I'm going to end it. So, see you later if you're watching on YouTube, Facebook.